Hello, my dear students. I am Sunira from Department of Physics, Government College, Madappally. In this lecture, we will learn about coupling constants and classification of particles. This lecture is part of Particle Physics of Nuclear Physics paper, which is in MSc third semester physics course of University of Calicut. This lecture is based on the textbook Particle Hunters. Now, in our previous lectures, we learned that there are four fundamental interactions and each of them have their own properties. So, if you want to compare all these interactions, it is a difficult task because each of these interactions have their own conditions. So to compare with equal settings is a tedious task. For example, think about a hydrogen atom. As all of you know, in a hydrogen atom there is an electron and a proton. Okay, so there is a Coulomb force or electrostatic interaction between the electron and the proton. At the same time, these two particles are massive and so there is gravitational interaction also. Okay, but here this electrostatic interaction is 10 raised to 39 times greater than the gravitational attraction between them. Okay. Similarly, think about two protons. In the case of two protons, the electrostatic interaction and the gravitational interaction, the ratio of electrostatic interaction to the gravitational interaction is given by 10 raised to 36. Because in this case, gravitational interaction is a bit greater. Because here there are two protons. Okay. Similarly, when we think about electron and positron, as all of you know, positron is the antiparticle of electron. Okay. So, in the case of electron and positron, there is Coulomb interaction. Okay, the electrostatic interaction is just like in the case of electron and proton. But this gravitational interaction is completely different in this case, in the case of electron and positron. Okay, so the ratio of electrostatic interaction to the gravitational interaction is given by 10 raised to 36. Okay, so in all these examples, we can see that electrostatic interaction is same, but gravitational interaction varies due to the variation of masses of the particles. So, in order to compare the four fundamental interactions in nature, theoretical physicists formulate a dimensionless quantity. This is known as coupling constant. Okay, so coupling constant is a measure of the strength of the forces. It is a measure of the strength of the forces. Okay, we can evaluate this coupling constant from the cross-section of the interaction. We can evaluate this coupling constant from the cross-section of the interaction. Actually, this is the probability of the interaction. So, if the cross-section is very high, there is high probability for the interaction. Okay, so coupling constant is a measure of strength. It is evaluated from cross-section of interaction. And this cross-section of interaction is equivalent to its probability of interaction. Okay, so the unit, the cross-section is measured in the units of area. For large value of cross section means the large probability for the interaction. Okay, so similarly, The coupling constant may be derived from the average lifetime of a particle which decays spontaneously due to certain type of interaction. Okay, so we can evaluate a coupling constant using average lifetime of particles which decay spontaneously. Otherwise, we can find out this coupling constant from the cross-section of interaction. Anyway, the coupling constants vary from one interaction to another. So, on the average, the ratios between the strength of the strong electromagnetic, weak and the gravitational forces were found to be 1:10⁻²⁻²⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻ is stronger than the electromagnetic force. Strong force is 100 times stronger than the electromagnetic force. Okay, similarly it is 10 raised to 13 times stronger than the weak force. Strong force is 10 raised to 13 times stronger than the weak force. Okay, similarly it is 10 raised to 39 times stronger than the gravitational force. Strong force is the most strong force. Okay, this force is 100 times greater than electromagnetic, 10 raised to 13 times greater than weak interaction, and 10 raised to 39 times greater than gravitational interaction. Okay, so now we can think about certain examples. First one is a beta decay. All of you know that in the case of beta decay, a neutron decays under the influence of weak interaction and it transforms to a proton and an electron along with an antineutrino. Okay, this interaction is called beta decay. Okay, here the interaction is shown here. Neutron decays to proton plus electron plus an antineutrino. Okay, the average lifetime of the neutron is 17 minutes. We already discussed that the coupling constant related with the average lifetime of particles which spontaneously decay. Okay, in the case of neutrons, it spontaneously decays within 17 minutes. Its lifetime, average lifetime is 17 minutes. When it decays, it transformed to proton plus electron plus anti-electron neutrino. So, the lifetime of the reverse interaction. Suppose this reaction happens in the reverse, there, inverse beta decay. The lifetime of the reverse interaction is also 17 minutes. That means in this case, electron antineutrino plus proton produce neutron plus a positron. In the case of inverse beta decay, neutrino, antineutrino, electron antineutrino interact with a proton and produce a neutron and a positron. Okay, in this case, the neutrino must be in contact with proton on the average for 17 minutes. The case of inverse beta decay, the average lifetime as in the case of neutron decay. So, this time also the neutrino must be in contact with proton. That means usually proton is inside the nucleus. So, when the neutrino and antineutrino roughly interact with the proton roughly for 17 minutes. Okay, so what happens? As all of you know, the cross section of the nucleus. What is cross section? We already discussed that it is the unit, its area actually. So, the cross section of the nucleus is about 10 raised to minus 8 of the cross section of the atom. Okay, so how much area for the atom? In this case, the nucleus the area of the nucleus is less than this area of the atom. This ratio is nearly 10 raised to minus 8. Because all of you know that the diameter of the atom is angstrom, 10 raised to minus 10. When it comes to the area of cross-section, how much is it? Around 10 raised to minus 20, right? Similarly, in the case of the nucleus, it is the radius or the diameter of the nucleus is around 10 raised to minus 14 meter, okay? 10 raised to minus 14 meter. So, the area of the nucleus is around 10 raised to minus 28. So, the difference in the cross-section. What's the difference in the cross-section? 10 raised to minus 8. The ratio. Here, the cross-section of the nucleus is about 10 raised to minus 8 of the cross-section of the atom. So, when neutrino passes through matter, it comes in contact with proton only 10 raised to minus 8 of the time. You get the point? That means we already discussed the cross-section of interaction. The ratio of cross-section of the nucleus to the atom is 10 raised to minus 8. So, when a neutrino passes through the matter, it comes in contact with the proton or it comes in contact with the nucleus only 10 raised to minus 8 of the time. Okay? So, the neutrino must travel through the matter for 17 into 10 raised to 8 minutes because it has to spend 10 raised to minus 8 of the time. So, 17 into 10 raised to 8 minutes. It want to travel through the matter around 17 into 10 raised to 8 minutes on average for this interaction. Within this time, the neutrino travels a distance of 3 into 10 raised to 16 kilometers. 3 into 10 raised to 16 kilometers. Because neutrino is nearly zero mass and it moves with velocity nearly c, the velocity of light in vacuum, 3 into 10 raised to 8 meter per second. So within the time 17 into 10 raised to 8 minutes, this neutrino travels a distance of 3 into 10 raised to 16 kilometers. This is all about the inverse beta decay. So what happens? The cross sections of these reactions are extremely small. It is very rare interaction. The cross sections are extremely small, which is of the order of 10 raised to minus 19 bonds compared to the typical nuclear reaction cross section of 1 bond. Bond means 10 raised to minus 24 centimeter square. Okay. Usually the nuclear reactions have the cross section of interaction nearly 1 bond. But in this case, in the case of inverse beta decay, it has only 10 raised to minus 19 bonds of cross-section of interaction. So, inverse beta decay is a rare phenomenon. As a second example, we can think about photon absorption of the materials. Okay, photon is absorbed by an atom after it has penetrated the substance to an average depth of 3 into 10 raised to minus 9 meters. Okay. So, around this much depth, a photon can penetrate through the substance, 3 into 10 raised to minus 9 meters. Photon traverses this distance in 10 raised to minus 17 seconds. Okay, within 10 raised to minus 17 seconds, photon traverses a distance 3 into 10 raised to minus 9 meters. Usually, if we think about photon of visible light, it has an average wavelength of 5 into 10 raised to minus 7 meters. This about 1000 times greater than the diameter of an atom. Okay. 5 into 10 raised to minus 7 meters is about 1000 times greater than the diameter of an atom. So, the photon comes in contact with so many atoms. How? Since its wavelength is 5 into 10 raised to minus 7 meters, it can travel through thousands of atoms at one direction. It can penetrate in depth to 3 into 10 raised to minus 9 meters. So, the photon comes in contact with so many atoms. If the photon were in contact with one atom at a time, its absorption would take 10 raised to 9 times or 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. Okay, usually when a photon penetrates through the matter, it interacts with many atoms. But if it happens, it interacts with only one atom, the absorption would take within 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. Okay. If an atom can absorb energy, all atoms can't absorb energy. If an atom, for example, in the case of a glass, glass cannot absorb visible light. We can discuss, we discuss here about visible light. So, some other material, an atom can absorb energy, then the atom and photon to be in contact at least 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. Okay, the photon and atom together to be in contact at least 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. If an atom receives necessary energy, it emits a photon with the same time interval. Within the 10 raised to minus 8 seconds, if an atom receives necessary energy, it releases a photon with the same time interval. Okay, so the time interval required for photon absorption and the photon emission are same. But its cross-section of interaction can be different. That is the point. The case of beta decay, the cross-section of interaction is greater than the cross-section of interaction of inverse beta decay. Okay. So, we can compare 1 and 2. When we compare these examples 1 and 2, the neutrino must be in contact with a proton for an average of 17 minutes for its absorption via weak interaction. For the absorption of a photon by an atom, it requires only 10 raised to minus 8 seconds through the electromagnetic interaction. The absorption of photon is almost 10 raised to 11 times faster than the neutrino absorption. So here we discussed two examples. First one is neutrino absorption and the second one is photon absorption. Neutrino absorption takes place through weak interaction with a long time, 17 minutes. But the photon absorption is happens through the electromagnetic interaction within a short time as 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. So, the absorption of photon is almost 10 raised to 11 times faster than the neutrino absorption. So, the electromagnetic interaction is stronger than the weak interaction by 10 raised to minus 2 by 10 raised to minus 13, which is equal to 10 raised to 11. The absorption of the pion by the nucleus is a strong interaction. It happens after a small number of collisions. The third example is the absorption of the pion. Absorption of the pion by the nucleus. This happens through strong interaction. So this interaction happens within a small number of collisions. At the same time, the absorption of a muon by nucleus by a weak interaction is a rare event. Okay, so there are some this much examples we discussed here. So the absorption of the pion by the nucleus, this happens through the strong interaction. Here it happens within a small number of collisions. The absorption of the muon by the nucleus by a weak interaction is a rare event. The spontaneous decay of the pion is a weak interaction. The pion is the lightest particle which is affected by the strong interaction. Okay, so this pion cannot decay through the strong interaction. There is no other light particle which is affected by this strong interaction. But these are unstable particles. So these pions spontaneously decay through weak interaction. Okay. Similarly, the gravitational force has negligible effects on these experiments in particle physics. And so the gravitational force has very low coupling constant comparing with other forces. Gravitational force has very low coupling constant. Now we can check the rate of decay. See, we already found that the decay of particles have different times. But here, different weak interactions occur with various speeds. Decay of neutron is very slow process. We saw that it has nearly 17 minutes. The lifetime of muon is 10 raised to minus 6 seconds, microseconds. The lifetime of charged pion is 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. The lifetime of strange particle is about 10 raised to minus 10 seconds. Rate of decay depends on many factors. Anyway, different weak interactions occur with various speeds. The rate of the decay depends on the difference between mass of the decaying particles and that of its products. For example, in the case of the neutron, the mass of the neutron is only slightly greater than the mass of the proton and electron. So, neutron decay is a slow process. The lifetime of a particle helps to determine which interaction is responsible for its decay. From the knowledge of the lifetime, we can predict the interaction type for its decay. The lifetime of particles which decay by electromagnetic interaction lie between 10 raised to minus 16 seconds to 10 raised to minus 20 seconds. Similarly, the decays caused by the strong interaction are faster by about 3 orders of magnitude. The mesons are considered as the carriers of the strong force at the nuclear level. Basic carriers of the strong forces are gluons. Now we can summarize the discussion about the four fundamental interactions. So the first interaction is strong interaction. This is strong interaction. It has relative strength 1. Because we keep this strong interaction as reference. Its range is nearly 10 raised to minus 15 meters or 1 Fermi. And the carrying particle is mesons. Mesons mass is greater than 100 MeV and its spin is 0. Now coming to the second electromagnetic interaction. Its relative strength is 10 raised to minus 2. Its range is infinite. Carrying particle is photon, its mass is 0 and spin is 1. The third one is weak interaction. In this case, its relative strength is 10 raised to minus 13. Range in meters is 10 raised to minus 17. And carrying particles are neutral Z, W plus and W minus particles with mass of the order of 10 raised to 5 MeV and the spin 1. The fourth one is gravitational interaction. Its relative strength is 10 raised to minus 39 with range infinite. The carrying particles are gravitons which has mass 0 and spin 2. Okay, these are the main characteristics of the four fundamental interactions. Now we can discuss the classification of particles. So, elementary particles can be classified based on their spin and sensitivity to the strong force. Based on spin, we can classify them as fermions and bosons. Based on sensitivity to the strong force, we can classify them into four, such as baryons, mesons, leptons, and intermediate bosons. Based on spin, we already discussed that we can classify the particles based on spin into two. The first one is fermion. So in this, we can check the properties of fermion. These particles have half integer spin in the units of h cross. That is like this, 1 by 2 h cross, 3 by 2 h cross, 5 by 2 h cross, like that. Usually the matter in this universe are built by these fermions. The next property of the fermions are they obey Pauli's exclusion principle. So two identical fermions can never occupy the same vicinity of the other, the same vicinity. No identical fermions, no two identical fermions cannot occupy the same vicinity. Okay. Similarly, the fermion number is always conserved. So, in a reaction, if a fermion is created, there should be another fermion which should decay. Okay. Or destroyed. The fermion number is always conserved. That is a property of fermion. Now, there are certain conservation laws exclusively for these fermions. In addition to energy, momentum, and charge conservation. And electrons, nucleons, short-lived hyperons, and neutrinos. All these are fermions. Now the second type of particles are called bosons. These particles have integer spins in the units of h cross. That is with the spins 0, 1, 2, etc. into h cross. But in the case of bosons, they have no restriction. Any number of bosons can occupy a small region in space. That's why there is formation of Bose-Einstein condensate. All bosons in a single state. In the case of bosons, it is possible. Any number of bosons can occupy a small region in space. So, here the boson number is not conserved. So, bosons can be created or annihilated without restriction. There is no restrictions for bosons. They have no special conservation laws. They have only classical conservation laws such as energy, momentum and charge conservation. Similarly, these are the carriers of the basic forces. All the carriers of the basic forces are bosons. Now, we can move on to the second type of classification. That is based on sensitivity to strong force. So here we can classify the particles into four categories: baryons, mesons, leptons and intermediate bosons. So what is this baryon? Baryons are fermions. These are affected by the strong force. Examples: nucleons, hyperons and their antiparticles. As all of you know, nucleons bind together in the nucleus. This happens through the strong force. Okay, so what is baryon? Baryons are fermions which affected by the strong force. Now what about mesons? Mesons are bosons. These are also affected by the strong force. Example, 3 pions, 4 kyons and eta meson. These are the mesons. Leptons. Then comes leptons. These are unaffected by the strong force. Leptons are unaffected by the strong force. They are electrons, muons, tons and their respective neutrinos and corresponding antiparticles. Then comes intermediate bosons or gauge bosons. These are the bosons which carry the basic interactions. Okay, so based on the sensitivity to strong force, we can classify these elementary particles into 4: baryons, mesons, leptons and intermediate bosons. What is then this intermediate bosons? There are 4 carriers of electroweak interaction. We already learned about in our previous lecture. Okay, there are 4 carriers for electroweak interaction: photon, W plus, W minus and neutral Z particles. In the case of gravitational force, there is gravitons also. All these these particles are not affected by the strong force. Okay, at the same time there are gluons. Actually gluons are the carriers of the strong force. This happens between the constituents of the nucleons. Okay, so these are affected by the strong force. These are not directly observable. Gluons are affected by strong force. At the same time, the particles of electroweak interaction and the gravitational interaction are not affected by strong force. So we can check now what are the particles affected by strong force. So we found that baryons are fermions, these are affected by strong force. Mesons are bosons, these are affected by strong force. So there are 2 types, one group from fermion and one group from boson. These together, these baryon and meson together called hadron. These hadrons are affected by strong force. Okay, so the various groups of the particles are not closed. The decay of a particle in a particular group may belongs to another particle in a different group. So in this case, the groups are not closed. The decay of a particle from a particular group may lead to the formation of another particle in another group. For example, baryons and mesons decay in many cases into leptons. Leptons means electrons. For example, we already discussed the neutron decay. Neutron is a baryon. This baryon neutron decay to proton plus electron plus antineutrino. So there is electron. Electron and antineutrino is leptons. Okay. So baryons and mesons decay in many cases into leptons. A photon with enough energy may turn into electron-positron pair, which is known as pair production. In this case, you learned about pair production. Here photon, as all of you know, photon is an intermediate boson. Okay, that means photon is the carrier of electromagnetic interaction. So it is an intermediate boson. This intermediate boson, if it has enough energy, decayed into or transformed into electron-positron pair. These 2 electron and positrons are leptons. Okay, so here is also the interaction is not closed in the group itself. Most of the interaction involves particles of more than one group. Now we can summarize these points into this slide, this particular chart. Here you can visualize this as a group of elementary particles which can be classified into two, such that fermions and bosons. The fermions are further divided into leptons and baryons. Electron, muon, proton, neutrino and their all antiparticles includes in the case of lepton. The examples for baryons are nucleons, lambda, sigma, eta, omega, mesons. Baryons, nucleons, lambda, eta, sigma, omega, all these baryons. In the case of at the same time, when we come to the case of bosons, bosons are divided into two, mesons and intermediate boson. The case of intermediate bosons, we already found that they are carriers of basic interactions, photon, W plus, W minus and neutral Z. Then gluons, then gravitons, all these comes under this intermediate bosons. And the other group of the boson is mesons. Mesons includes pions, kaons, etaons, etc. So here the mesons and baryons are affected by strong interaction. These together called hadrons. Now we can conclude this lecture. In this lecture, we learned about coupling constants of fundamental interaction, its definition, how is it evaluated, and its importance. Then we move on to the classification of elementary particles. We discussed the classification based on spin, fermions and bosons, and based on sensitivity to the strong force, baryons, mesons, leptons and intermediate bosons. Hope that all of you understand what we discussed here. Please read the section 6.2 and 6.3 in the textbook Particle Hunters. Happy learning. Thank you.